Well, hello there, amazing and wonderful nerdy people of YouTube. So we are at it again. We have found something crazy among us, and that is IPStorm. Linux have gotten a malware that can go and do a lot of things. Granted, this is not so spread as under Windows, because it started out on Windows. I'll go into it a little bit. You should not start to be afraid now and not go on your Linux machine and pray to the gods and, you know, swing a dead cat over your head 5 times to make sure you don't get infected. The chances are you are not infected, but you need to be aware that these things are out there. If you're on Windows, that's another thing. We are talking about Linux people right now. You can still get infected with this one. It's just not that as widely spread because it's still kind of new and it has target Asia, I think it is, and I will go into that in a little bit because there's an infection radar where they have infected it most. And it also seems like it's targeting IoT devices, Internet of Things devices, more than servers and stuff like that. That's what one article says. Again, take all of this with a grain of salt. Do your own research. I will put link into some sites down below where you can read up about this. But seeing that here's talking about that IPStorm, which is a malware botnet that has first been spotted last year targeting Windows system, has evolved to infect other types of platforms such as Android, Linux, and Macs. And you can go, they talk a little bit about its story and it's working to peer-to-peer. It's also CSS system. Or it target SSH, and it's not so sophisticated, but it still works. Bitdefender and Barracuda's talking, that's the guys I have up here, talking a little bit about it. What they can do, like what they did under Windows, is it allowed them to execute PowerShell commands, and therefore they can do a lot of things. They can also use your PC as part of a botnet that do denial of service attacks. So you probably heard about gamers not being able to log into games, or gamer streams go offline, or services getting down, and they're talking about denial of attacks. It's basically, think of it this way. When you ping a system, you take up bandwidth. So if you ping Google, you take up bandwidth. So if thousands of computers are pinging a server and stuff like that, you can potentially over-succeed the bandwidth that server have. So that's why you get into denial of service. Basically, that means that there's so many people trying to get in the door that you can't get in the door because it's just packed. You know, they basically are denying you access by overloading their bandwidth. That's roughly speaking what's going on. So you can't be part of that network. And a lot of computers nowadays are part of a bot network that do that without them knowing it, because it don't take a lot of resources. You just have to ping, basically. So again, you can read a little bit about it here. So here, Bitdefender, which is a really good antivirus program for Windows. They're talking a little bit about the CSA threat bots, and I will go into something else in a little bit, what it's targeting, IPStorm here. It's, again, IoT devices. It's actually called Interplanetary Storm because it's using the Interplanetary Storm's peer-to-peer network on, it's a file system thing and stuff like that. I won't go into crazy details because then we can sit here and talk about analytics and sniffing methods and how to see if it's working and how it's working. You guys can do that for yourself, because then this video will be fucking 5-10 hours long. And here we are looking at Barracuda, Threat Spotlight, new Interplanetary Storm variant targeting IoT device. These are the guys here that targets that are talking, that is mostly targeted about IoT devices, but your Linux machine can still be targeted. It's just not the main target. And here you get a little bit of a representation of where you live in the world, how much infected you are at the moment. So Hong Kong, South Korea, and Taiwan have 59%, Russia and Ukraine 8%, Brazil 6%, United States and Canada 5%, Sweden 3%, China 3%, and all other countries are less than 1%. So if you don't live in one of those countries, be aware, but again, less than 1%. And again, they talk a little bit about threat analysis and stuff like that in here. Go read up about that if you're interested in it. These guys here talk a little bit more about IPStorm's infection routine and functionality. And again, they talk here that it's able to do PowerShell commands and do DDoS attacks like denial of service, which, like I said, is basically just roughly speaking, they're using hundreds of computers, thousands of computers to basically ping one site or go into one site so other people cannot use it. It's a method that, if you heard this terminology, script kiddies. You know, you see some kid, oh, I don't like you, you killed me in Call of Duty, or blah, 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 and I will fucking DDoS you and stuff like that. What they do, they go onto a website where you can buy DDoS attacks, so you can, like you can buy, I want like a day or 30 minutes, or I want 10,000 computers to DDoS attack this site for X amount of time. There are sites where you can do that. You don't need to be a hacker, it requires no skills, you can even download programs, I think it's Ion Cannon or something like that it's called, where you can download programs and then you can just target websites. It's DDoS attacks, my grandmother can do it. It's so simple, it's like downloading a program and then do it. So if you're one of those script kiddies and think you're like a fucking hacker for doing DDoS attacks, like come up with something fucking intelligent. So yeah, that's what's out right now. Again, as they say here, it's not that widely spread here in the EU and in the States and Canada. Well, Sweden have 3%, but let's face it, Sweden, they probably got drunk one day and forgot to put up a firewall and stuff like, you know how Swedish people are? We know it. I live in Denmark. I know all about the Swedish people, so I can tell you many, many stories. But yeah, you get what I'm saying here. It's not like you should now toss your fucking Linux machine out the window because now it has AIDS or something like that. No. You just need to be aware, just like with any other viruses out there, you need to be aware that you can potentially get affected. So don't just open anything you get and click on anything you see on the internet. Be a educated user of your technology, and then you won't get into that, especially on Android devices and macOS and iOS. There's a virus going around for Android phones right now. I can't fucking remember what it's called, but it has affected millions of people. And also, this here, they have quadrupled since last year, the IPStorm targeting system or the IPStorm malware. The last part of this video is about open source. So a lot of people in my comment section, when I'm like, do we even know if open source is good or bad? Well, right now we are targeted by a malware, and it don't seem like it's being handled that well, meaning that there's no fixes out for it yet, and it's like at least 5 days old, if not more. It is using, as I was talking to a guy about, it's using SSH brute forcing. So it's not that sophisticated, and that could also be why it's not that easy to handle. So are we more secure for being on Linux? We don't really know because we don't have the install base of Windows. They are primarily talking IoT devices, Windows devices, and then secondary Mac and Linux devices. Also, the developers of IPStorm when it came out for Windows in the beginning, they were talking about that it was like a research project and they will stop doing it after like a couple of time. But they seem to have lied to us and they're still going into it. And another thing about open source is that there are something called IRC Flu, which is an open source based bot that you can use for malicious intent. And apparently it's using JSON API calls and stuff like that. So this is a virus or an infection or whatever you would call it that is open source. You can see the code for it. So open source don't always need to be used for good. And just because it's open source don't mean that it's always secure, because the way people are talking in my comment section, they are saying that stuff like IPStorm would never happen, because people can look at the source code and see security faults in it and stuff like that. And again, if people have the opportunity, but if they don't do it, you are fucked. That's the thing. People automatically expect that just because you can look at the code, people are doing it. And that the people are doing it know what the fuck they are doing. Like, yeah, I can change the tire on my car, but that don't make me a mechanic. Well, I am a mechanic, but that don't make everyone a mechanic. You get what I'm saying here? You will fuck things up, and then also, yeah, but they learn while they fuck up. Yeah, they learn while your system is vulnerable. You learn on a personal level, but what? Let's say you're managing a fucking server farm and stuff like that. Do you think your boss is like, hey, Joe, we just got infected. Yeah, but boss, I am actually learning right now. And they're like, you just cost us like $500,000. Yeah, but I'm learning, boss, because I'm learning from my mistakes. You get what I'm saying here? That don't fucking hold water. So I'm interesting what this is. I haven't read up much about this, but it actually came in with this IPStorm here. That is targeting, again, IoT devices, Windows machines, Linux machines, and macOS machines, and stuff like that. And or Androids, of course. But I find it really, really interesting that there are open source malware, bot, virus, call it what you will, out in the open, and nobody's really talking about it. Are we secure against it? I don't know. We have overrated these attack with a mass scanning campaign, blah, 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 blah. Like, it's really, really interesting. And what I'm saying here is that just because it's open source and it sounds good, it sounds fancy and stuff like that, just remember, nothing is guaranteed. Nothing, it's not guaranteed that it's only good people looking at the code, and all the people looking at the code know what they are doing from a security standpoint, from an optimization standpoint. It's not automatically giving. The same, just because it's proprietary and closed source don't automatically mean that the coders know what they're doing and they have security people looking at it and stuff like that. Basically, no matter what license you're using your code for, it don't automatically think that, oh, because I'm using MIT, it's more secure, or I'm using open source, it's more secure, or I'm using proprietary or closed source licenses that it's more secure. Nothing is guaranteed. Some have some advantages, some have some disadvantages. Just because you have an open source project don't necessarily mean so that you have more people editing the code. You know, an open source project can have, let's say, one security expert, where a closed source project can have hundreds because they get paid for it in a lot of instances. It's not guaranteed that just because it's open source, you have more people looking at the code. I have a lot of examples of that if you want to let me hear more about that, and personal examples also. So that's basically it. Be aware of what's going on out there. Don't think that just because you are running Linux that you are immune, or because you're running Android that you are immune, or macOS or iOS. If people can make a bug, or they can be a nuisance or a big fucking dickhead towards you, they will do it. It's just that we are not that big of a target right now. And that's why I have this notion that Linux security is still not being proven. And I know you guys would say, well, Linux runs on 50% or 55% of the servers in total. Here's the thing. The way server farms handle security compared to how you handle security in your home are night and day. Like, they don't run antivirus on all their Windows VMs that they have running on a server. They have servers that are honeypots, and they have servers that are traps and stuff like that. So their internal network, where all those instances run on, are more or less secure by that the virus or the attacks has to go over 5 different firewalls and antivirus traps and honeypots and stuff like that. Big example, I helped a guy like 10 years or more than 15 years ago, I think it was, said they had to have done something in a server room. And I went in there and I was like, yeah, you need those rails set up there so I drill some holes into a wall. And he came in with a fucking XP machine. And I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? And there was a big fucking label on it called virus trap. That was what I was like, what the fuck are you doing? Why do you need that in here? Like, why is it? And I was like, virus trap, what the fuck, what's going on here? And he was basically said, well, it's basically a honeypot or a bait. So if someone attacks our network and they see this unsecure system, you know, they start to more than likely they will focus all their attention on that one because, oh, we got in there. But in reality, that little part or that computer had nothing to do with the network. It was a hoop or a device that you can look up on the network, but you didn't really have anything to do with the network. So it's kind of like, you know, script kiddies and stuff like that. They will go into that one, and then you have to go through firewalls and hardware, antivirus and anti-hacker-proof stuff, and software anti-hacker, antivirus-proof stuff and stuff like that. So it's totally different beast when we are talking server room security compared to your personal home security. This here is your personal private home security we are talking about. They may not even be able to SSH attack their way into our corporate world or corporate server farm like that easily as they do under your system or IoT devices. IoT devices are notorious for not having firewalls or any security measures on their on them. They just connect to a network and they just probably like drive down the lane. You could probably hack in really, really easy into a fucking fridge source, you know, a remote control alarm clock or something like that because they have no security whatsoever. People have just forgotten about security in IoT devices for some reason. And then they use, then they infect the IoT devices, and then you log on to your IoT device to do some tweaking, and then they infect your computer, and then you're fucked, basically. That could be a talk for another day. Anyway, I'll see you all later. I hope this was a little bit interesting.